ॐ सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्. सो वि सॉ इन् द लास्ट् क्लास् दट् आल् प्रमाणस् वेदर् इस् वैदिकं लौकिकं वा विल् फङ्क्षन् primarily to remove ignorance. Removal of ignorance is the fundamental nature of a pramana. Action based on that knowledge etc. comes later. Okay, this much was elaborately discussed last time. Are there any questions or clarifications on this? On the functioning of a pramana, or is it all clear? Remember the definition of a pramana: abhadita anadigata jnana janakam, that which will give you knowledge which is not negatable and which is not gained by any other source. It has a uniqueness about it. That is called jnanam, and that is a function to give that knowledge is a function of a pramana. Clear up to here? Okay, I'll assume that all of you are clear and we'll go ahead. Now in this, from verse after verse 20, 21st verse onwards. Having said this much, we also find in our experience that there are times when a pramana gives you wrong knowledge. Now, since all of you don't seem to be having a doubt, maybe in your house, if there are a lot of disturbances, mute your mic. That option is available for you all. Mute the mic. Okay. Now, we find from our experience that there are some times when the pramana doesn't function as a pramana, you get Brahma or erroneous knowledge, like your perception. You mistake a shell to be a coin. A shell is mistaken for a coin. This happens quite often. Since this is there, this type of issues are there, one has to generally address the issue of wrong knowledge, of erroneous knowledge, otherwise known as adhyasa. So in the next few verses, what the Vartikara does is address the question of adhyasa, which reminds me that I had asked people to revise the definition of adhyasa from the adhyasa bhasha and the various views on it. How many of you have done it? You had 2 weeks because last Sunday we didn't have a class. Hey, this is my senior class. I expect you all to take it seriously. Okay. Okay, what is the simple definition of adhyasa? Can anyone give me?
Atho Atasmin tadbuddhi.
Atasmin tadbuddhi. Yes. To have the buddhi of not that on that. Meaning to mistake something for something else. What else is added to it to make it more complete? Paratra para avabhasa smriti rupaha purva drishtaha. Remember, those two terms are added. Smriti rupaha meaning smriti tulya, because it's not a real object. Purva drishtam, you should have known it before. Only then the definition is complete. Why does this need for dealing with adhyasa come up in Vedanta at all? It's necessary because the vision of Vedanta is completely different from our vision. We see ourselves as a finite entity in this pluralistic world. In this world, which is so vast, which seems so real, I am a finite entity. This is what causes my sense of finitude. In the vision of Vedanta, I am nothing but the limitless consciousness, and the world is just an appearance. Now I cannot understand myself as limitless appearance unless I see the world as an appearance, as mithya. Then the question will come, I am mistaking the reality to be the world. That means limitless consciousness, which is one Advaitam, is mistaken as the many. That means even though my vyavaharika pramanas are functioning, and even if the Vedic aspect, the Purvamimamsa of pramana is functioning, there is still an error in terms of adhyasa. A common error right across the board, therefore nobody takes it as an error, everybody takes it as a fact. All that you know as aparavidya from the Shastra or from the world is actually speaking, dealing with adhyasa. Even Vedanta Jnanam is based on adhyasa, in as much as because you have taken yourself as a finite being, there is a need for the teaching. So the teaching is not to create anything new, but to negate your ignorance about yourself. Since that is the picture, one needs to deal with the question of adhyasa. And that's where the issue lies, because universally everyone takes the world as real. Even the scientists dealing with quantum physics, who can see that there is a certain ephemeral nature in the whole thing. Non-definitive nature of things. He says, well, that's only at the quantum level. The other things is different. Therefore, there is still a lot of reality given to the world, and there is still a lot of finitude on myself. Therefore, to make our understanding of Vedanta clear, one needs to handle this question of mithyatvam, this question of adhyasa. Otherwise, we will take ourselves as consciousness, all right, but as a pocket of awareness here, the finitude will not go. If you see some modern writers on Vedanta, you find that this problem is there. They take themselves as consciousness, as awareness, and when they dismiss the world, they only dismiss the world that we have created in terms of our political ideas, socio-economic ideas, etc. But hey, the coronavirus seems to be real. Yeah, that is how we'll take it. How do you see that threat that you are facing is nothing but an adhyasa, a mithya thing? Having only vyavahara yogyatvam, not reality. It has some functional validity, that is all. And therefore you have to deal with it at a functional level. And to be able to see the whole thing as mithya and I alone as a satyam. Therefore, keeping this in mind, all writers of Vedanta, traditional writers of Vedanta, will handle the question of adhyasa or erroneous knowledge. Without establishing adhyasa, without dealing with the question of adhyasa, you cannot really establish Advaita. Though it is true, Advaita is a fact revealed in the Shastra. For that to be clear in my mind, I need to understand adhyasa very, very well. And to see that all the notions I have of the world, all the notions I have about myself, however valid they may be, however functionally valid they are, is still in the realm of adhyasa, in the realm of mithya. This apparent dichotomy your mind should be able to hold well. If my mind cannot hold this apparent dichotomy, that something can be functionally valid, at the same time it is not real. Unless my mind can hold that, my Vedanta Jnanam is very shaky, is on very shaky footing. Therefore, it becomes necessary to understand adhyasa, and that's exactly what he is doing here. Verse after verse, dealing with the problem of adhyasa. We will see the verses, and in some place, I may go back to what we have seen earlier in the adhyasa bhashya. Okay? But let us see a couple of verses, what he says, and then it becomes necessary to refer back, we will do that. Okay. So again, you have a week to go back and refer to the various definitions of adhyasa and the various way different schools of thought look upon adhyasa. This will come under the section of khyatis, panchakhyatis, akhyatis in the adhyasa bhashya. Okay. Now he starts the 21st verse by saying, Jadanurta parichinna deha dharma chidatmani.
Jadanurta parichinna
deha dharma chidatmani. Satya jnana sukatmatvam.
Satya jnana sukatmatvam.
Moha dehe pikalpyate.
Moha dehe pikalpyate.
Shukto rajatamityevam. Yada vamo hyade nayata.
Yada vamo hyade nayata.
Mukhyante anyata. Okay. Jada anrutta parichinna deha dharma chidatmani. He says here there is a mistake between jadam and anrutam. That which is jadam, anrutam, parichinnam. Jadam inert, anrutam not real, parichinnam finite. He says, deha dharmaha, which are all deha dharmas, chidatmani is imposed on the atman. And satya jnana sukhatmatvam, what is real, what is existent, what is of the nature of jnanam, consciousness, and anandam, which is here presented as sukhatmatvam, out of delusion, moha, dehe epi kalpyate, is imposed on the deha. For which he gives an example, shuktam rajatam ityevam, like mistaking a shell to be a piece of silver. Yatha vyamukhyanti anyatha, how elsewhere you will say vamukhyanti. There people make this vyamoha, this mistake. Look at it. When you are mistaking a shell for a piece of silver, a rope for a snake, whatever the example is, two things happen. The qualities of the shell that is existing, that is there in front of me, is imposed on the silver, and the qualities of the silver are imposed on the shell. Same thing happens in Atman Atmadhyasa. Jadatvam, inertness of the body. Anrutam, not being permanent. Parichinnam, being finite in terms of time and space. Which are all deha dharma, is taken as my dharma. This is me. And my nature of satyam, not completely. Satyam is total existence on which everything is imposed. But that is seems to be imposed on the body, that the body exists. It is functional. Jnanam, it is sentient. Not the whole consciousness is imposed, but some of that. Like, not the whole consciousness, but the fact that the body, which is really made up of inert materials, appears as sentient. Sukhatmatvam. And there is a certain degree of pleasure, happiness, etc., available through the body. Therefore, if you look at it, they are mutually superimposed. Body on the self, self on the body. Therefore, I will end up saying, I am this much only. And this, he says, moha dehe vikalpati. All this is because of moha. There can be 100 reasons why you make a mistake. Sometimes, like in rope snake, it is because there is not enough light. In the case of the shell and silver, it is because there is too much of light. But they are not sole reasons, they are only secondary reasons. They are not primary reasons. They are secondary. They help. The primary reason is, I don't know what is there is a piece of shell. I don't know what is lying there is rope. This ignorance is fundamental. That is a fundamental reason. If you knew it was a rope, all the darkness in the world will not make you mistake it as a snake. If you knew it was a shell, all the brilliance in the world of light will make you mistake it to be a piece of shell, as silver. Therefore, it is this ignorance which is responsible for adhyasa. One needs to keep this in mind, that without ignorance of the basis, there is no adhyasa. There are schools of thought which says there is only adhyasa, there is no mool avidya, which is not true. If there is no ignorance, there will be no mistake either. Without ignorance of the reality, whether that reality is functional or absolute, there can be no mistake or adhyasa. Therefore, ignorance is fundamental. With ignorance, a mistake may happen or may not happen. If ignorance is total, as in deep sleep, it will not happen. In fact, ideally, for adhyasa, you should have ignorance about the thing. At the same time, it should be available to you as this. Supposing you are walking on the beach and completely miss seeing the shell. Completely. You don't know that it is there on itself. You will never mistake it for a piece of silver. If your ignorance of the rope is total, you are not even aware of something lying there, then also you will have no mistake that the rope is a snake. Therefore, for adhyasa to take place, you need to have some awareness, what we call as idantaya jnanam. At the same time, there should be sarupa jnanam, ignorance of its true nature. And this is exactly what happens in the case of the Atman. I know I am, I exist. This is irrefutable. The most ignorant man in the world knows I am. It takes a lot of thinking to foolishly conclude that sometimes I am not there, or to attribute my existence to something else. I am is a self-existing fact and known by itself, svata siddham, svata jnatam, swayam jyoti. It is known without the need for any other pramana. That being the case, with respect to the Atman, there is a totally conducive conditions. There is totally conducive conditions for adhyasa to take place. Because I know I am, I exist. At the same time, I don't know my true nature. And I am closely associated with the body, mind, etc. Therefore, perfect condition for adhyasa to take place, for a mistaken notion about myself. Therefore, I should be able to see this very clearly. I must see this very clearly, that this body, this mind, etc. is not true. It's only an adhyasa. This is not me. It's only, at the most you can say, a role that you're playing, a dress that you're wearing, an apparent manifestation of yourself. Not true. And that is very necessary to understand that. Very necessary to make this clear in your mind. That means it involves two things. Look at it. No adhyasa can exist independent of the adhishtana, the substratum, if you want to put it in English. Okay. Without adhishtanam, there is no adhyasa. There has to be something for you to make a mistake about it. That something is called the adhishtanam. The mistake is the adhyasa. The adhyasa is only a mental construct seen outside, because it's definitely projected onto the rope or the piece of shell, not elsewhere. I don't take the body as something else, I take it as me. Therefore, the body is imposed on me. I have to see that clearly. Not only that, the adhishtanam is independent of the adhyasa. The substratum is independent of the adhyasa. But the adhyasa is dependent on the substratum. These few points have to be very clear. The snake is dependent on the rope. The rope is independent of the snake. Snake is something that will disappear in the presence of light. The rope will continue. Similarly, even when the body and mind is negated, I continue. Therefore, it is not enough just to say I am not the body, mind, etc. Though that's important. I also have to see this very clearly, that I am independent of the body. Body and mind is dependent on me. This is what will make your understanding of avidya and adhyasa very clear. Vedanta will be easy then. That I am independent of the body and mind, and the body and mind is dependent on me, is superimposed on me. Another thing is, the substratum, the adhishtanam, is not tainted by any guna of what is adhyastam, The slimy snake that you saw on the rope does not make the rope slimy. Gandham api nasti. There's no smell of the snake itself. It has to be, that point has to be recognized very, very clearly. That no amount of adhyasa can touch the substratum. In other words, all my self-judgments about the body do not touch what I am. All the difficulties, the pain, the conditions of the body does not touch me. I am independent of them. The limitations of the body remain at the level of the body, not me. Similarly, all my hurt and pain and guilt at the level of the mind, my anger, my intolerances, my biases, none of them touch me. None of them contaminate me. I am completely free from that. Those things have been imposed on me because I don't know my true nature. Therefore, the self is free. I am free from all those things. Even though right now I have all these problems in my mind. Not only that, the even ignorance is superimposed on the self. The self is not ignorant. Like how the cloud is seen in the light of the sun. The cloud that appears to cover the sun, which actually only covers my vision of the sun, is seen in the light of the sun. Similarly, the ignorance that I have about myself is objectified in the light of the consciousness that I am. Therefore, nothing that is adhyastam superimposed on me, the adhishtanam, the basis, affect me in any manner. That means as I am, with all the problems that I face, I am totally free and independent. So can you see the effort that goes in proving that all that is there is adhyasa? And therefore, when other schools try to dismiss adhyasa, the first thing they will do when they are trying to dismiss the Advaita standpoint, the first thing they will do is try to dismiss adhyasa. Because if the world is not adhyastam on the self, how can the self be limitless? Because if the world was had some reality with respect to the Atman, if it had this similar degree of reality, then there is no moksha actually. There is no Advaitam. Therefore, to dismiss Advaitam, you need to dismiss the whole idea of adhyasa. Therefore, all schools of thought that attack Vedanta will try to dismiss what adhyasa is. Now I am doing an overview first. In the overview, you will find all the attacks in terms of trying to dismiss adhyasa will take it either that adhyasa is real, therefore not an adhyasa, or adhyasa is not real, meaning it is not there at all. Do you remember all this from the adhyasa bhasha? That's why I said there's a 2-week gap. Listen to the adhyasa bhasha. Okay. Go over and read it again. Read your notes again. You can listen to all the cassettes that have been put up, all the video recordings that has been, audio recordings that has been put up. But definitely, you can read your notes and come into it. Okay. Look at it. Many schools of thought will be interested in showing that adhyasa is real. That means what you are seeing If you have to discuss things at home, please mute your mics. If you have to dismiss Adhyasa, one set of arguments will say that what you see as Adhyasa is not Adhyasa, it is real. Okay. Can you all hear me now? Okay. If you can, someone please message me to say if you can hear me. Okay. Therefore, if you say that Adhyasa is real, then what you are trying to say is the piece of silver that you saw on the shelf is real. The snake that you saw on the rope is real. That means what? There is no Adhyasa. That means that silver has some validity. You have become a little bit richer. Or the snake has a validity. You can extract venom from it. But we know from experience that is not true. That whatever is adhyastam disappears, is negatable. It is not valid. Excuse me. You may all say, but there are certain things where the experience will continue. That is true. The flat earth does not disappear when you see the round earth. But that does not make the flat earth real. It only gives you an experience of some validity. And however valid that experience of the flat earth seems, we all know for a fact that it is round. Therefore, we are not overcome by the fear the Western world had in pre-Columbian days, pre-Columbus, that if you sail too far out in the sea, you will fall from the edge of the earth. Therefore, I think we got disconnected for the time being and we have reconnected now. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Because I think the connection dropped for a second. Beg your pardon? Sorry, I cannot make out what you are saying. Yeah, as far as I am concerned, it is on fully now. Okay. If any of you cannot see or hear, just check your connections. Okay, I think what is happening is, hello, are you all on? Please respond, are you all on? Can you see and hear me? No. Can you see me? Can you hear me? Okay, looks like I have come back. Okay, with that condition being there, however much you experience a flat earth, we all know it is round. And therefore, we don't have the fear of the sailors in the Western world before Columbus, who thought they will fall off the end of the earth if we sail too far. So given that condition, we have to say that we cannot take the world as real. You just cannot take it. How do you take the world as real? How do you take what is adhyastham as real? You cannot do that. Then the question will come, what about the adhyastham being totally unreal? If what is superimposed is totally unreal, okay, that means the snake is totally unreal. There is nothing called a snake at all in the world. If there is nothing called a snake at all in the world, how do you see it on the rope? An unreal snake, meaning a snake which does not exist. When you say totally unreal, you mean totally non-existent. What is totally non-existent cannot be superimposed. That's why the definition, smriti rupam purva drishtam. You should have some memory of it. There should be, it's smriti tulyaha, and it should have been seen by you before. That means there was some empirical existence for it. Somebody who has never seen a snake in their life, not even a photograph, not even on the video, not even on TV, will never mistake okay, for the video, what is happening is, today there is a janta curfew, a mass lockdown, and therefore everyone must be on the net. So the connection keeps dropping sometimes because I think there is an overload on the net. This is for those people who are on the, who are going to watch the video. So if the snake has never been seen by you before, never known to you before, neither on a photograph or a video or on TV, there is no way you will mistake a rope for the snake. Therefore, if it is totally unreal, meaning non-existent, you will not make a mistake. If it is real, absolutely, then you will never be able to negate it. Therefore, this is the stand that Vedanta takes in harmony with our experience, that whatever is adhyastham, whatever that you see on the adhishtanam as superimposition, what you see has to be sad asadbhyam anirvachaneyam. Neither real nor unreal. If it is totally non-existent, you would not see it. If it is totally real, you will never be able to negate it. But we find that whatever is adhyasa, like the snake on the rope, is seen, the shell is perceived all right, the snake is seen all right, at the same time it is subject to negation. Just because it is seen, it doesn't become prama, valid knowledge. Why? Because prama is not subject to negation, and here you find it is subject to negation. Therefore, whatever is adhyastam is sat asadbhyam anirvachaniyam. Cannot be definitely concluded as sat, cannot be categorized as asat. Therefore, we will say kinchid bhavam asti, it has some sort of existence. It does not have the same degree. The whole world has enough reality to create an experience for me, but not enough reality to become real as I am. That means, on knowing myself, the reality of the world is negated, but the experience of the world can continue. Kinchit bhavam asti, some sort of existence it has got. Because if it did not have that type of an reality, you will never be able to experience the world and gain both pleasure and pain out of it. It has, that is why in Vedanta, even though the reality is only consciousness, me, I am the only reality in the world, consciousness is the only reality in the world, even though that's a fact, we do give some reality to the world as well. That's why we say, I being the real is paramarthika satyam, the absolute reality, and the world has got a vyavaharika satyam, a transactional reality. And in our experiences, in our interaction with the world, what we do is further, a second degree of superimposition comes in, that of my pratibhasika reality, my subjective reality is imposed onto the world in terms of my likes, dislikes, biases, etc. Therefore, when Vedanta talks about the experiential world, we will give these three degrees of reality. One which is absolutely real, and the other two which makes up this mithya world, but we will give some reality to it by saying kinchit bhavam asti, it is vyavaharikam, it is functionally valid, or pratibhasikam, it is only subjectively valid for a given person or a small group of people. That's a subjective validity. Why? Because if it is valid for everyone, the subjectivity becomes vyavaharikam. And these are not hard and fast divisions. These are not compartmentalization. Things move from one to the other all the time, except the fact of absolute reality. All these confusions come up because the absolute reality is not recognized. Therefore, we are not dealing in Vedanta, we are not dealing with the mithya world or with adhyasa to prove the reality of adhyasa. The idea of adhyasa is brought in to deal with the extra reality of the world that people are given it. Instead of just keeping it as something experience, we take it as because its experience is valid. This is another problem that comes in understanding of Vedanta, that experience is valid. Whereas we find all the time in the world, our experiences really do not deal with reality. That is why the same thing can be experienced in different manners by different people. And just because a whole lot of people think or have a similar experience, that doesn't make that experience valid. Like the whole Western world thought the earth was flat. Why am I keeping on saying Western world, Western world? Because in India it is always described as golam, a ball. Something round. So I am constrained to use the word Western world. The whole Western world thought the earth was flat. That didn't make it so. So sometimes, in fact very often, your conclusions, your perceptions of the world makes your reality. Nobody lives in the world as it is. We always live in the world we think it is. Therefore, we give it some validity. Why? Because there is an experiential validity for it. The mistake that happens in modern times, over and above all the traditional talk of Vedanta, the traditional unfolding, over and above that, the problem with the modern world is that experience is given more validity, more weightage than it really deserves. We think if you have experienced it, you have got it, which may not be true at all. Your experience may be purely subjective. How do you know it? No experience can be replicated in exactly the same manner. Why? Because you already got through it once, it will appear different the second time. That's why the famous Zen statement, you can never step into the same river twice, because already flowed past you. And to that I answer that, are you sure you can step into it once? Because by the time you decide to step into it and step into it, it has already flown past. But the fact remains that too much of weightage is given to experience. In fact, I find it creeping into modern Vedanta that is the experience of the Atman that will make it valid. Your anubhava is necessary. The traditional word anubhava, the Sanskrit term, is used in the sense of knowledge, not in the sense of experience. Primarily in terms of knowledge, secondarily in terms of experience. Therefore, don't say anubhava and translate it as experience. Yeah. It's important to see that, because otherwise we all will hanker for an experience in Vedanta. Some experience of samadhi or whatever the modern teachers want to call it. But experience by its very nature is adhyasa. And if you are talking about total negation of all adhyasa, it happens in deep sleep and you are not wiser for it. Remember, in the waking world, in the dream world, there is an adhyasa about yourself. There is an adhyasa of the world. Plus, ignorance of yourself and the world. The reality of yourself and the world. That ignorance is there, plus adhyasa of the world and yourself is there. In deep sleep, there is no adhyasa. All the adhyasas have been negated, resolved. But the ignorance is there. That's why, in spite of that experience of lack of adhyasa, you don't come out any wiser. If the self becomes an object of an experience for you in some manner, that is purely because of adhyasa. Because all experience is in the realm of adhyasa. Because there is a duality there of you and the experiences. Therefore, those experiences also, all your spiritual experiences, fall in the realm of adhyasa. They may be more valid, less valid, we can debate on that until the cows come home. But the fact remains is that it is in the realm of adhyasa, because it's an experience. An experience is time bound, space bound. It's conditioned by time and space. Therefore, it falls within the realm of adhyasa. So to see the whole world and all my notions about myself as adhyasa, to see that this body of mine These ideas of mind are all adhyasa. Or any more easily acceptable word, conceptual. There's another thing, the word conceptual. People use it in the study of Vedanta and say, I've got all the concepts of Vedanta clear. A professor once told me that, Swamiji, all the concepts of Vedanta are clear. I said, sorry, yeah, sir, your concepts may be clear, but Vedanta is about breaking concepts, about negating all concepts and understanding the non-conceptual self, the non-conceptual reality. Therefore, all adhyasa has to be negated and the self seen as it is. And the only way is unfoldment of the pramana, the use of the pramana, no other way. But to make the fact that you are limitless consciousness clear, we deal with the question of adhyasa so that we can see the whole world as something that is adhyastam. All my notions about myself, including my functional validity of the body, mind, etc., as adhyastam. Only when this adhyasa is clear, will Vedanta be clear. You cannot have clarity in Vedanta without having clarity in adhyasa. Remember, Vedanta is, the pramana is not dependent on adhyasa. The pramana, the shastra, stands independent by itself. But for me to understand that, what is implied in the shastra of adhyasa has to be made clearer. And that's exactly what Bhashyakara has done in the Adhyasa Bhashya. He has taken the idea of adhyasa, which is implied in the shastra, and made it very, very clear. And that's exactly what the Vartikara Sureshwara, his own student, is doing in this Manasolasa in the next few verses, making it clear. Any questions or clarifications at this point? If it is, shoot. Now is the time to ask. Hello, have all of you muted yourself so much that you can't hear me also? You can hear me.
We can't see you, but we can hear.
Okay. Have any questions or doubts on this idea of adhyasa? On anything that I have said today? Are there any questions, any clarifications necessary? See, today is also Janta curfew. Therefore, everyone is at home and I'm sure using the net very heavily with all your Amazon and Netflix and whatever happening. That's why sometimes the connections have dropped and come back again. Okay. So this is a good place to stop. It's a shorter class than normal. It's a good place to stop. What I would really ask you all to do is go back and look at the five khyatis that we discuss in Adhyasa Bhashya. Yeah, look into what the text I have given you. Look into the notes that make it clear, so that the next class your understanding will be refined even further. Okay, I think that's fine for today. Enough for today. Om Tat Sat. Thank you. Thank you all. Good of you all to join. I think for the next couple of classes we may have to do it online. So it's fine.